All right. Joel Klatt played college football, set all the records at Colorado. Not like they were a big bar there, but nonetheless, you broke some records in college. And now you're a great analyst for this network, growing some facial hair. No, I'm just joking. Okay, so...
It's good to see, by the way, it's great to be here with you. It's
I think
so
you're
good
our
to be
first
here.
Live guest.
Is this it?
You're our first live guest. Who was here? Well, Acho works over there, so that's not really fair. He stumbled over here.
Right, yeah.
We scheduled you.
There we go. And I came in just for you.
Thank you.
You bet. All Enjoy.
Right. And maybe you noticed.
Good to have you back, Joel.
It's good to be back.
Did you notice anything different about me?
Yeah, your facial hair.
What do you
think? Which is why I didn't shave either today.
That's out of respect.
Out of respect, yeah, that's right, for my elders.
Like No Shave November or something, isn't that a thing?
Yes, it is. Maybe we'll do Movember. There we go.
Yeah. So I'm going to be suspicious. Big J journalism.
Okay.
So I look at all these Big Ten schedules that come out.
Oh, yes.
Funny.
I know where you're going with this.
Yes, the conference gives Ohio State their only national championship contender a cakewalk for 2 months.
Let's be fair, though. Let's be fair. Ohio State was going to be double-digit favorites against any Big Ten team anyways, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know.
Time out. They got rolled by Purdue and Iowa last 2 years. That doesn't mean anything. This team has gone belly up the last 2 years and gotten rolled against average teams.
No, that's wrong. Actually, last year they were the first team in the history of college football to go 9-0 through a regular season through a 9-game conference schedule and win the conference championship game. So go 10-0 through a conference schedule. The year before, yes, they did lose to Purdue.
You
said the last 2 years, not 2 years ago.
Okay. The point being, Big Ten gave them a cakewalk to the national championship.
I don't know if you can say that they went out of their way for Ohio State. Here's what I will tell you. I felt like the top two teams in each division got really solid crossover games.
All right.
Okay. So when you're crossing over to the other division, so for instance, I think that the three most favorable schedules in the kind of new iteration of the Big Ten schedule were Ohio State because they don't have to play themselves. Then you've got Minnesota and Wisconsin. And the reason is because Minnesota and Wisconsin are, I think, the two best teams in the West, and they miss both Penn State and Ohio State from the opposite division because I think Penn State's a little better than Michigan this year. Meanwhile, the two losers, the team that got absolutely hammered, everyone's been talking about Nebraska, but Michigan as well. Those are the only two schools that have to play the top two teams from the opposite division. And then in Michigan's case, they also have to play Ohio State and Penn State in their own division.
So Jim Harbaugh was very outspoken against the conference. Do you think the Big Ten stuck it to him a little?
You know, I want that to be true just because I'm with you, right? Like the college football, I want these types of rivalry and conspiracy things to be accurate. So it's
out there.
Hey, Scott Frost and Jim Harbaugh, we're going to stick it to you. But in reality, the guy who pushed the hardest and maybe did the most from a coaching perspective to bring the Big Ten back to a point where we're going to play fall football was Ryan Day at Ohio State. And in fact, his AD was very prominent. Their doctors were prominent. All their president was prominent. If you wanted to pin why is the Big Ten playing football this fall, it is because Ohio State pressed as hard as they did, and then they got what would be considered a favorable schedule.
Okay, it's really funny in the NFL right now. Because of Lamar's success and Kyler Murray's success, even somebody like me, which was always kind of pocket guys win, little mobility fine, don't need it. I kind of look around at Justin Fields at Ohio State, and I'm like, this Trey Lance kid at North Dakota, and I'm like, boy, you got to run.
Yeah.
Although, let's talk Trevor Lawrence, because Clemson's the best team I've seen so far. I don't have much to work with,
sure,
but he's great. In your years of doing college football, is Trevor Lawrence the best prospect?
No, I still think Luck was.
You think Luck was better than him?
I think Luck was in the years I've covered college, but it is razor thin. I hesitate there. Part of the issue is that I don't think Trevor has had the level of competition, in particular in the ACC, right? Like, I don't know. The Citadel, I'm not getting much. We're throwing against
air,
basically.
No, it's been a junk conference for 4 years.
So, but that being said, man, I mean, he's as good of a prospect as
I've
seen.
He's got a better arm than Luck.
Luck had a very good arm. Luck was bigger, a little bit more physical, a little bit more mobile, although we saw last year in the semifinal against Ohio State the athleticism from Trevor. I think Trevor is and probably should be the number one pick. But you bring up a great point, because in today's NFL, it's no longer we have to get the pocket passer. Now what we have to do is we've got to get the best football player for the position. And Kyler is proving that out. Lamar is proving that out. These guys are great throwers of the football and are showing the acumen to pass the football at a requisite level and the athleticism. And that's where Fields pops in. Because Justin Fields got so much better last year as a passer from week one all the way until they played
Michigan.
No,
Justin Fields looks like the NFL today. This is what the NFL, he can make the throws, he's sturdy, and he moves well.
And he moves really well, but more than anything, I just felt like his ability to throw the ball, in particular downfield, got so much better last year. And you got to credit Mike Yurcich, who's now the offensive coordinator at Texas, but also Ryan Day for their development of him. Because I will tell you this, not this last spring, but obviously the spring before it, when he first arrived from Georgia, Colin, I was standing with Ryan Day at a spring football practice in their indoor facility in Columbus.
Look how easy he throws.
But I got to tell you, he was throwing the football on the field, and Ryan goes, "We got a lot of work to do." He was not a finished product coming from Georgia, and I think that the system, the coaching, Ryan, Mike Yurcich, and then Justin Fields' work ethic brought him to a point where he's as good of a passer down the field as anybody in college football, which is why it's not going to be just totally cut and clear who the number one pick is for some of these NFL teams come next spring.
Yeah, he's good. All right, so listen, SEC play starts this weekend.
Yeah.
This is the shocker of college football. Alabama doesn't get to play Panera Bread seven times. So Alabama got a little bit of a tough schedule.
Well, not only a tough schedule, everybody in the SEC. This is going to be, I think, the most interesting year to watch SEC football ever, because they're all going to play 10 games.
No cupcakes.
No cupcakes whatsoever. League only. Just to give you a sense of how different it is, Nick Saban only twice during his tenure at Alabama has had to play five consecutive weeks without a bye, a group of five, or an FCS.
That is ridiculous.
Okay? That's the most. And it's only happened twice where he had to play five consecutive Power Five opponents on consecutive weeks. By the way, did you know one of those was 2012? Guess which opponent was fifth? Texas A&M with Johnny Manziel, and they lost that game.
Yeah.
Because they couldn't defend Johnny Manziel. Last 2 years, so 2018 and 2019, for Alabama, the most consecutive weeks that they played Power 5 opponents was three.
That is brutal. This is what drives me nuts about Alabama. I'm not saying they're not good, but it's like Tom Brady. You put him on the road in the playoffs, he's 500. His division had no question helped Tom Brady.
Sure.
Nick Saban manipulates this thing around. He's just looking for a truck stop. He can roll nine guys out and win.
So they're going to open the year with six straight consecutive weeks against the SEC.
Good teams?
They're all pretty good. Remember, the SEC is deeper this year because Tennessee is better. Kentucky's better.
Florida
A&M is better. Florida is better. You still have Georgia. You still have Auburn. You still have LSU.
Watch Alabama get unveiled a little bit.
Maybe, but I don't know if it'll matter because, remember, we're still taking the four best teams. I think this is the year that we might get a two-loss team into the college football playoff.
I'm okay with that.
Because the committee's going to say, listen, with that schedule, they're still one of the four best teams, and I'm okay with that as well.
I like Saban's Aflac commercials, but I hate his schedule.
The schedules are terrible.
Embarrassing, kind of.
You know the last time he went on the road in a true non-conference road game? Penn State in like 2011, I think it was.
Brutal.
That's brutal.
Like,
you're right.
Nick's running a schedule like he doesn't think we watch the games. He's like, hey, I'm pulling a fast one on everybody. Nobody's watching. No, Nick, everybody's watching because you're the program of note. He doesn't go on the road.
Georgia, by the way, got hammered in their schedule. They're going to play five ranked teams in a six-week stretch.
Whew.
Wow. I can't wait to watch that play.
That's going to be great. All right, what do you got this weekend?
I've got at Oklahoma. We've got Kansas State at Oklahoma, we hope. I was in Waco last Friday when
things
that game
unraveled
went away.
Quick.
So we'll see what happens. But I can't wait to watch Spencer Rattler. I think he's the next great college prospect.
He's a sophomore or a redshirt freshman.
He's a redshirt freshman. His arm talent is through the. I have not seen a young quarterback with his arm talent Mahomes.
Let's slow down now, class.
I just said arm talent. Mahomes. He's got all you got to do is look. I just watch the tape, folks. You know,
I am here to protect the children.
Spencer is a great athlete.
He is.
You
and
guys
his
got
arm
him
is insane.
You did this with Joe Burrow. God, he was Joe Montana, and he was in diapers. Let's slow down. This Spencer Rattler's beating a bunch of teams.
Joe Burrow had the single best college football season any quarterback's ever had, and he's got the feet of Joe Montana. I don't know if his career is going to pan out
to be Montana.
One
guy cares about the kids on this set.
Oh, my gosh.
I care about the kids.
Oh, my gosh.
You got him throwing them out there, making them Superman. It's like, let's slow down on Spencer Rattler.
Let me just give you some perspective. Last year, Patrick Mahomes, the longest throw he completed in the air was 53 yards. It was in the Super Bowl to Tyreek Hill. You remember the play?
Yeah,
it was the big play.
Yes.
Whatever they call it, Razor or
running
whatever.
Around. Yeah,
yeah. I mean, great throw, right? And everyone's like, "Oh my gosh, look at his arm!" Last week, albeit against a terrible team in Missouri State, Spencer Rattler off his back foot threw a ball 52 yards in the air on the money for a touchdown. Like, his arm is incredible. You're going to get on board. Don't worry. I mean, I watched the film. I don't know what you're doing. You're out there watching surfers. Great. 80-story build. I watch football.
God. You know, you and Nick Wright, what's the point? There's no win for me. I'm up here. I'm a dartboard. You guys are just throwing heat at me all the time.
Well, but like a dartboard, you're easy to hit.
Oh, gosh. All right. Well, we run out of time. Your mic doesn't work. That's unfortunate.
It's still on.
Okay.
The red light's still on.
By the way, check engine light comes on. Don't freak out. Get carshield.com. Carshield.com. No anxiety. They pay for everything once your warranty's over. Carshield.com. That's Joel Klatt. That's Joy Taylor. She's got the news. Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd or go watch a few segments from other shows on FS1.